Each autumn would come around and jobs on the dairy farm slowed, and we would look forward to heading out to the bush to camp with family and friends. Picking a campsite was important. Not too dusty, not under the red gums, along the creek bank with easy access to the water for the punt, but most crucial of all was plenty of firewood for the campfire. Our children were very young, but the babies were put in playpens, while a length of chicken wire acted as a safety barrier for the toddlers. The kids grew, and so did their sense of independence and freedom of enjoying the bush. It didn't matter to swim in amongst the water weeds with mud scorching up between their toes. They cooperated in building cubby houses from leaves and branches, making flying foxes, and then taking in turns. They listened while an adult explained how to catch a fish or how to hold onto a yabby. Bath time was easy. Jump into the creek, tip a bucket of water over your head, or lay back and relax in a tub. The men cooked the camp oven and then sat back and contemplated, smelt the eucalyptus, enjoying one another's company. During the day, we had boat safaris. The punts allowed us to explore along the creek and follow great meanders between forest and farms. The kids were quick in spotting birds, seeing bubbles float up from turtles, or ask what the scar was on the old dead red gum tree. Enjoying the bush was one thing, but I wanted to know more. Each year the Bar Creek Tree Group organised bus trips out into the forest. We invited guest speakers to come along and impart their knowledge. A botanist explained native vegetation and bush tucker, such as kabungi, dillon bush and old man weed. An ex-forester helped us understand the Aboriginal connection. A woodcutter explained the old and new way of milling timber. Even now, when I take visitors out into the bush, I'm able to impart this valuable knowledge, and in most cases, I receive new information. In 1992, I was lucky enough to travel through the flooded forest. To me, there's nothing more magic than seeing the bush after a rain or in flood. Just add water and our backyard becomes a paradise of native flowers, breeding birds and swarms of insects. Going along Chettle Track, the big tree loomed up out of the water. It left me with a sense of wonder at the ebb and flow of life that this tree had seen over the last 800 years. Had it seen a drought as we have it now, and are my grandchildren going to see this giant of a forest surrounded by the water of life again? For all of us who love our special backyard, we need to appreciate and preserve what has been taken for granted for so long. We need to tell the stories and allow the future generations the enjoyment that we have had.